Thanks, everyone. Hi, my name's Dale, and I'm the CTO of Nominini. I'm going to be talking about our small team of seven developers' journey building our second product and taking it to market in less than 6 months, and share with you some of the lessons that we've learned along the way. But before I begin, I always want to get an idea of who's actually dealt with hardware before. Has anyone done a Raspberry Pi, like installed a media center or something? Okay, cool, quite a few people. Arduinos, a little bit of home automation, that kind of thing. Cool, yeah, nice. Actually built some hardware, 555 timers or an amplifier. Yeah, sure, plenty of geeks in the room. Laid out a PCB? Yeah, okay, cool, that's great, thanks. So I'm going to pull back the curtains a little bit for those who haven't taken a hardware product to market, because we use electronics every day, and I'd like to show how we've gone about designing and developing and manufacturing some of our own hardware. We reside on a continent where 55% of Africans, or about 500 million people, live off less than 15 rand per day, without reliable access to water, electricity, telecommunications, and even basic banking services. And the governments can't raise the capital to build the infrastructure, because once it's built, there's no way to charge consumers to buy those products. So what we're trying to do at Nominini is build a payments platform that allows communities to buy essential services easily and reliably. So our platform, very briefly, is made up of several parts. We've got the hardware, which is the point of sale systems, which you see on the left. And we've got a transaction backend hosted on Google Cloud Platform that's running everything from containers to on App Engine, some VMs as well. And then we've got our management dashboards that, so if you're a distributor with thousands of points of sales terminals, need a way of being able to managing those. And so we offer things like insights and analytics and various prediction services and that to cost effectively run a deployment. And then of course the various integrations into the mobile networks, into the electricity providers, the banks, whatever else. So today's talk is going to focus on the hardware and share with you why we made some of the choices that we did. In 2011, when we started, the predominant way of getting prepaid products out is with the scratch card. So it's got a one-time pin behind some wax, scratch it off, and you can enter that in your phone or your electricity meter. But the major problem with that is that these cards are effectively equivalent to cash, and transporting them long distances costs a lot of money, and there's a large risk in that they could be stolen and then sold on the black market. And the pirates in Somalia were basically buying airtime from the mobile networks and selling it below cost so they could give like customers a huge basically discount on the airtime. So the way that they could bankroll their operations in hijacking ships. So it is a big problem. And one of the solutions is to deliver these products wirelessly so they can't be stolen in transit. If you're going to deliver stuff wirelessly, it needs to go somewhere, such as either a phone or a point of sale system. And it needs to be cheap. You know, we want to democratize access to essential services, a lot of which are a basic human right. Many towns in Zambia, for instance, they've got one 24-hour store. And people queue for hours to try and get electricity when they should be at home with their kids or cooking dinner. And that's no way to spend an evening. Also, if you can make it cheap enough so many people in the community can sell these products, that wealth stays within the community. You know, you go and you buy something from Pick and Pay, that money is not going to go and stay in the community where the Pick and Pay store is. It's going to be sent back to HQ. Literacy is a major problem. So one of the first things that we did was get rid of the screen. We chose specifically to go for buttons only, simple numbers, buttons, colors, text, and logos. People that we've dealt with have never used a smartphone before. You have to try to educate someone how to use a touchscreen, and that's like something that we take for granted, but many people have never used a touch phone before. And with 12 buttons, you think maybe it's a little bit limiting, but in this case, there's three networks and 9 denominations. They can sell 6 products. You can make it 27 products. You can sell 6 networks and 6 denominations, giving you 36 products. And if you're really brave, which only one of our crazy clients has done, they've got 12 products and 12 denominations by overlaying everything. So you can select 144 products, which, so, you know, even though it's just 12 buttons, you can still do a lot of things with it. One of the questions I'm always asked is why not use a feature phone? And 2 reasons. One is trust. If you're going to hand over a large portion of your daily income to some guy standing on a street, you want to be sure that if it doesn't work, if you buy that electricity and it doesn't work in your meter or it doesn't work in your phone, that there's some recourse that you have. And having a piece of paper, a receipt, gives you that form of trust. Also, many people don't feel comfortable going to a stranger and handing out their telephone number or, say, their electricity meter number or their banking details to someone, a stranger. So they would far rather get a piece of paper with a one-time PIN and do it on their own time. Also, speed is hugely important. If you want a merchant running through a taxi rank, you want to be able to sell as quickly as possible to when the commuters are traveling through your area. So you need a printer. And my favorite reason for develop hardware is making it robust. You know, Africa's a rough place. People are using products to sell products, which is their livelihood, and they need it to work all the time. You know, rain, dust, wind, it's a big thing. And getting it dropped is trying to make it so it can survive being out in the street. So I've got one of my terminals here, which I'm gonna throw around. See, this is our first generation product. Lots of plastic, very thick, and it's designed so you can chuck it on the floor, and yeah, okay, the plastic explodes a little bit, but you can reassemble it really quickly. So when your CEO goes and chucks it down a flight of stairs, I mean, that was our design for spec. there's been another case in Kenya, and this container I went and visit. The guy's shop burnt down the one night, and about the only thing that survived in it was our point-of-sale system. And he came and fetched it the next morning, dusted it off, put some new like non-charred paper inside of it, and set up a stall next door. So that's his wife sitting there, and they've got a little lean-to roof, and got some more fruit and veg, and was able to carry on selling electricity and airtime. But one of our main learnings from that was, you know, we were using lithium-ion batteries, and we've all heard about the problems with lithium-ion. We changed the chemistry to lithium-ion polymer batteries, LiFePO, because they're a lot more stable. You can throw them in a fire, they can get submerged in water, you can stab them, they just won't explode, which is really cool. Power is also a problem. You know, one of the specs we had to get for 5 days. And when power is out, many places, I mean, we have it bad in South Africa at one stage. Other places, I think in Nigeria, it's often out for 20 hours a day. And one of our guys came to us and he sent back the terminal under warranty because it wasn't working. And when we opened it up, we found that like the power supply stuff was effectively just fried. It was blackened and charred. It's like, this is not warranty claim. What's going on here? Eventually, he told us that there was no power in his village and he wanted to charge the terminal. So he cut the USB cable and sort of stripped the ends, and he had a truck available, so he just puts it over the truck battery. And it's just, you know, it's supposed to be 5 volts DC and a truck's 24 volts. And he's like, oh, it didn't work the one way. I'll just swap it around and see. And it's like, fire. But the whole point, our learning from that was, well, these guys are going to do it. They want to sell because otherwise they can't earn money. So we put a specific converter in there to allow us to go up to 28 volts. So if you do like strip it and twist it and put on the battery, it's not going to break. And if you get it the wrong way around, it won't charge, but at least it won't fry it. So like these kinds of learnings. So my first learning that I want to share with you that we've had is that go and see. Now, we're a small company. We don't have a lot of money. It's a huge investment to travel far into Africa, and then you're going and to spend a day traveling, and then several hours to drive out into a village somewhere. There's time and cost to that. But no amount of video conferencing or WhatsApp chats or little videos is going to give you the same insight that an engineer or a developer who's actually in the country and seeing this can put all those little dots together and propose a solution and get that empathy by being with your clients out in the field. Because making someone's life just a little bit easier, compounding over time, leads to a really awesome product. So this is our first generation product, just showing you now. It was selling well, but airtime margins coming down all the time. I think they're at less than 5% now. And the real money is bill pay and account opening for banks. And for that, you need a screen. And we made this awful hack where we figured out that the printer, for whatever reason, the manufacturer made it so it can print in reverse and like pull the paper back and then print and spit it out again. So you can kind of see where this is going, right? It's a zero hertz screen as a piece of paper. So we had it that you press the button and it prints out some instructions, and when you press one for your, I don't know, meter number or whatever, it sucks the paper back in, prints over a one and spits it out again. And you're like, hey, I got a one. Two, same sort of story. And we just called this horrible thing jerky print. It was like, ugh, no, that was horrible. That's not a product that we can sell. So we went like, well, we've all had these Sharp calculators. I must have had one for 5 years that fell on the floor at my desk every single day. And those calculator screens, those little LCD screens, are bulletproof. So we was like, okay, well, let's put this into our product. And we took out the info button and the lock button and put a screen there, and we got it to, we did our Rev 8 board, all lined up for mass manufacture. We had got some clients who had pre-purchased it, and ready to go. Except enter the CEO. Several years later, or before, he had fallen in love with flexible e-paper. And a lot of you guys know e-paper from Kindle and the Nook and e-readers like that. And the way it works, just very briefly, is there's a clear piece of plastic on the top and on the bottom, and those are the anode and the cathode. And they've got black oil that's in between those layers, and inside of that is a suspension of titanium dioxide. And that can that reflects light, so it appears white, and the oil is black. And depending on how you energize those two layers, you can either get the ink or the titanium oxide to come to the top, and that then you can see white, and then that oil goes to the back, and then you swap it around, and then the titanium oxide goes to the back, and the oil goes to the front, and you can see the black. And the amazing thing about that is it only uses power when you're changing the pixels. So that screen is, it doesn't use any power when it's on. It's daylight readable because it's passive. It's fast enough. I mean, you're not going to do video on it very nicely, but we don't have that sort of requirement. And it's got really good resolution for things like text and logos. Then there's a company called Plastic Logic. And they, I don't know how they came up with this idea, but they wanted to make like a smartwatch snap bangle. So like a thing that wraps around your wrist and it's just plastic. And I don't know. I don't think they sold any of these things. But it meant they had a huge stock of these screens lying around, which we were like, yeah, cool. You can cut it, you can stab it, you can set the corner on fire, and you can bend it. And that thing was going to carry on working. I mean, that bit of the screen won't work, but the rest of it will, which suits us perfectly. And so the commercial team made a mock-up. I've got it here. The commercial team made a mock-up of this product, and they shopped it around to a bunch of our clients. They 3D printed it, they got it spray painted, lots of glue and sticky tape if you look inside here, and started to get some traction. And I found there's two ways of building a product. The first way, build it and they will come, will perhaps work if you're a large organization, got a strong brand, you can do your market research and know what people want, and have a huge war chest, so when you get it wrong, it's not going to bankrupt your company. We have none of that. But our commercial team knows that we do agile, right? So their approach is more like this. And they sold it. And not only did they sell, like, couple of these. They sold 2,000 of these up front. We got a deposit. And the previous biggest order that we had ever gotten was for 500, and before that, 50. So it was, and we had a few of these 500 orders, which was great, but now suddenly 2,000. But our CEO had done such a great job of selling this product that the requirements were from the client that needed to have e-paper and be delivered in 6 months. So tell Dell. When I was doing mechanical engineering at a steel mill, designing gearboxes and other things that kill you when you get it wrong, I've worked out that there was like this whole iterative development thing. And a problem that I ran into is each time you go around that development cycle, you start to subtly limit the solution space. You start off initially with an infinite solution space, which is great, good for making ideas, and then you start reducing that down by putting some requirements in place. And that's good because an infinite solution space can start to be debilitating. But each cycle, the intersection of the features that you can have starts to limit what you can do. And eventually you get to a point where you have a feature that just doesn't fit anymore. You can't accommodate it in the existing system. And yeah, maybe you can put some good development practices in place, like doing refactors or code modularity and things like that. But sometimes, and in our case, e-paper just broke everything. It would cost too much to completely retool the plastics and put the new electronics in place, and we even needed a new CPU to do this. So we had to build a new product. And I went to my mentor, and I was like, I've heard some horror stories. You know, I know about Duke Nukem Forever taking 15 years, and in the early 2000s, you know, there was Netscape Navigator, that they took so long on their dreaded rewrite that their market share dwindled to nothing. And there's many examples of a company's second product being just horrible and never really launching on time. You know, the first generation product has years of testing behind it and lots of little fixes for all the corner cases that we had discovered. And now we needed to build a second product that support the old while building the new. And it was going to take a long time to get to the same level of maturity. But our team's too small to be able to manufacture the old while building the new. And we've only got a limited amount of cash. We could either buy parts to continue doing the old stuff or move the company forward by spending that money on the R&D and to get the second gen product out. And what we did, we thought we were brave at the time, but actually I think hunger makes you do stupid things because we needed the money. We took that leap of faith, and that's my second lesson. Now you take a leap of faith to cancel a product that's working well and go to clients who've already put orders down for this product and tell them that they actually have to wait 6 months because we're going to focus on this new thing. Building a product is a hardware product. It's not really magical. It's just lots of attention to detail, like most development. And specifically, the cost of change is expensive. The pattern that we've made or discovered is when we outsource to other engineers, get them working on site with us. And we've found that getting like RF specialists in, the industrial designers, the guys are going to do the board layouts, working with our core engineering team for those two or three critical weeks allows us to have a much better product. We've got the 3D printed version, which is on the left, which I think is busy being passed around. The middle one is quite interesting. We call it the Spaceman helmet because rather than having a nice door, it's actually got like this huge bubble, which was very brittle, so we got rid of that quite quickly. But that is made out of plastic, injection molded plastic, but you can, rather than cutting a tool that costs R500,000 out of steel, you can get it cut out of silicon. And it's as good as production quality plastic, but you can only get 20 shots out of it. But that's fantastic for putting in printed circuit boards and checking fit and giving to clients as prototypes. And it only costs, about R4,000 just for the one. And then you can do a few hundred rand just for the extra shots. But it gives you a really cool idea. Once we've done that, then we could commit to spending that huge amount of money on the injection molding tools once we knew that it was all going to fit together. Doing a rewrite gave us the opportunity to re-examine some of our tech stack as well. Previously, we were using a proprietary operating system, and now we could move over to Linux and the whole GNU tool chain. We could use the ARM processor of our choice, which was really nice to be able to just choose exactly what we needed, the right amount of RAM and flash, and using the UBI file system, which I'll get to a little bit later. You know, the first generation product with its proprietary OS didn't even have a database on it. And, you know, one of my bonus lessons is friends don't let friends build databases. Like, if your requirement is to build a transactional database that's distributed across, like, hardware and a server backend, you're in for a world of pain. And we had a case where we just, our terminals, was making up, like, millions of rand. The client called it Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? And just randomly, there would be a buffer overflow in C++ somewhere, and it would just, like, change the guy's balance. And luckily, there's a huge audit chain, and it threw up all sorts of fraud alerts, so it didn't cause any trouble. But for that little guy's printout, it suddenly had a very large, like, 12-digit number of balance. Now we had SQLite, as well as things like network time protocol, ping and trace routes for network diagnostics, triple P for the modem control. And so our next lesson was that choose tools that have the largest community, even if the tool isn't a perfect fit. Because we found that, you know, you go and you ask someone on a forum somewhere, that someone is much more likely to be able to help you if you've chosen a well-known tool, versus, worst of all, building it yourself or using something that's not very well supported. We also had the misfortune of launching on Friday the 13th, and it didn't go very well. We sent our technical account manager, Koreshni, into the country with a bag of 50 terminals. Actually, I got one of them here. I'll show you. Cool. Sent her into the country with 50 terminals, and then 200 following her shortly behind. And when we did the development, it was over the winter of last year. There's no humidity in Cape Town, or very little humidity in Cape Town, and it's pretty chilly. And now they were sent up to Mozambique, where it was summer, because it was now November, and humidity approaching 100%. And our filters that we had built for the touch layer started going crazy. And they just started making random sales. We put it on the desk, and it was as if somebody was mashing the buttons as hard and as fast as it could, spewing out, at that stage, just fake vouchers. But the client wasn't happy. But our tool chain saved us. We've honed our continuous delivery practices over the last 5 years on the first generation product. And although we don't do continuous deployment, the code doesn't just roll out automatically, we still have some manual testing. We were able to go through this process of pushing up to Bitbucket. We use GoCD to, instead of Jenkins, to run our pipelines. That notifies our dashboard, which tracks things like what state firmware is in, or our software is in alpha, beta, or stable. And depending on the bravery or stupidity of our clients, they can choose to be on the alpha, beta, or stable channel of the firmware, and the devices in the background start downloading the code as soon as it's ready, at least the binaries as soon as it's ready, from Google Cloud Store, and installing itself. When we push code up to a server environment, you know, very often we think our environments look like this: lovely, clean data centers with clean power and air conditioned. They're good, reliable networks. And our data center looks more like that. You've got thousands of nodes spread throughout a continent. There's 100% humidity in places, temperatures in the upper 30s. And this is November, bearing in mind, at 37 degrees there. Dust, rain, poor power, and terrible networks. You know, the networks do crazy things, like, for whatever reason, block NTP traffic because they're worried about a DDoS attack. Or, you know, they want a static IP address to the cloud. And you know, you have to start setting up reverse proxies, and it gets difficult. And these devices can disappear from your network at any time. And some of the stuff that we've put in place a lot of that code is for the reliability. On the left, this is a memory map very briefly with the flash on the left and the RAM on the right. We have the secure bootloader, which ARM makes available to us, that you put a signed, you sign your images on the server in CI, and when it downloads it to the device, it will only install it or run it if the signature is correct. That then boots up the primary operating system, which then runs the primary app. And that will then go contact the server and say, I'm on the stable channel, give me the latest stable firmware. Downloads it into a scratch space and then restarts, and the bootloader will try and boot up the new version. And if that fails, we've got a thing there that a counter that if it resets more than 5 times in 10 minutes, then it fails over into the recovery OS. And that is in write-protected memory. So you can't accidentally overwrite your code. And you got other things in there as well, like using the UBI, which is the unsorted block image file system. And that's specifically designed for flash media. It's tolerant to power failures. It's got built-in data compression and wear leveling, error correction codes and encryption as well, if you want to put that on there. And for us, we've never had any problems with our file system, zero corruption, which is really awesome. And then hardware watchdog timers. If the app hangs for more than 10 seconds, then it just resets it and carries on. And then going from our first two lessons of go and see and collaborate on site, we sent our engineers up to Mozambique and rapidly fixed some of these problems, roll the code out over a couple of days, and that led to a lot of more happy customers. So the next lesson that I want to share with you that I've had is, you know, we're a small team and we specifically recruited for cross-functional people. So rather than cross-functional teams, find people, or we've managed to find people that are T-shaped. They're very deep in experience in one area, like electrical engineering or database design or architecture, but broad enough in all the other areas that they can fill in for each other and be a very dynamic team. And I know that the process that we've tried to design is for product delivery rather than delivering any one product. And that means that it doesn't matter where the business goes, that if you have an engineering practices that allow you to develop any product, you really can do that. So I'm confident that, you know, if Nominini does point-of-sale systems, that's great, and if they just want to start making rocket motors, I'm pretty sure we can use largely the same team. What does the future hold? Firstly, over the last year, we've managed to reduce our hardware development cycle from 6 months down to 3 months, and we've sustained that pace over 4 cycles. So within a year, we got 4 revisions of our board out on average in every 3 months. And that's largely been due to factory tooling and automation. And I'm not talking about like robot arms and stuff. I'm more talking about learning from DevOps, right, to automate everything. And this pithy comment we have stuck up on our Kanban board at the office. So every morning we're reminded that your job is to automate yourself out of your job. And so we send our engineers and our developers to the factory to work alongside the factory workers so they can see like what are the opportunities for making the product easier to assemble and just like having those insights that they wouldn't get if they were just sitting in the office or listening to feedback from the factory workers. And a simple change that we made for that saved a huge amount of money was being able to track and trace everything by putting barcodes. And literally from the resistors coming in from China to tracking through the pick and place machines to the ovens right through to the final assembly and into the field where we've got GPS on the devices, that we can understand our supply chain from end to end. And there's other great tools like automated optical inspection, that there's high resolution cameras that take photographs of the boards, and they can see whether any of the components are skew or missing and immediately flag it before it even gets to your automated test jig. And then of course automated test jigs and that as well. So we got down to 3 months, which is half of what it was. And that time, when we did the analysis of where's the development time spent and where's the manufacturing time spent, is largely within queues. And I know a lot of the network engineers here would probably know that, you know, as your system gets towards 100% capacity, the time that you spend waiting in queues increases. And if you're running an outsourced manufacturing firm or you're a consultancy that's got engineers or developers working for you, you want to, your objective is to use your team at 100% capacity. And that's because you otherwise they, your expensive resources, your people, your machines that cost millions of rand, sit idle. But what it means for us who needs to use them is a large portion of our time is spent waiting in relatively long queues. And in some cases for components, it takes up to 12 weeks to get something shipped to us. And our goal is to make the development cycle as short as possible. So we would need to have very little capacity being utilized to keep those wait times down. And we could do that. You know, if you're a large corporation, you could probably buy your own pick and place machines and set up a small factory. You could employ all those specialists. But for us, it's too expensive. So I think 3 months is a good time. It's about the optimum that we can afford at the moment without spending a lot more money. There's one more option that I want to talk about, and that's sort of the elephant in the room, which is Android. When we started in 2011, the state of the art really was the feature phones. They dominated the market. And the low-end Android phones were horrible. I don't know if anyone had played with those really cheap ones. They were clunky. It didn't really work so well. And the high-end smartphones were too expensive for the market that we wanted. So I think Nominini, if you look at this Clayton Christensen's idea of disruptive markets, you know, Nominini is a blue line we've been tracking, sustaining our innovation, trying to just improve the product year after year. But Android, now that it's got more than a billion devices, has the benefit of mass manufacture that we're never going to have. And with all the competition, has really brought the costs down. And over the last few years, with Moore's Law moving on, there's been a huge improvement in performance. So they've been rapidly climbing up that green line there to a point where it's good enough, and where Android phones and Android point-of-sale systems are cheap enough for us to be able to buy and our merchants to buy. So the next leg of our journey is going to be working with original design manufacturers, so ODMs, where we take the guts of an Android phone and work with a phone manufacturer who spent that huge amount of money and time developing the hardware and taking our expertise on industrial design and marrying those two so we can get the best of both worlds. And it brings some interesting challenges that we need to move from with a proliferation of hardware devices, possibly not our own, and like Android phones and apps, and every client that wants their own integrations, we need to start our journey from moving from our monolith that sells mostly airtime on our terminals to using more of microservices architecture to support these huge array of integrations and different devices. And I'm excited to hear over the next couple of days how other people are tackling that. So just to recap some of the lessons, the first one was that we've learned is go and see, and as engineers got a lot of insight into how, we can have lots of insight to how clients are using your product and be able to suggest improvements. Being brave enough to kill a product that is successful to allow you to have some space to grow what's next. Using tools from the community that are already supported and in the largest possible way, even if it's not necessarily the best fit for us right now. And then building a product delivery team, no matter what product we want to build, that we've got the team's got the ability to learn and adapt to build anything. And finally, automate away the boring work so we can focus on the value add that pushes the company forward. So that's me. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.